Je voudrais d'abord remercier les organisateurs pour l'invitation, même si je me retrouve dans cette difficile position de terminer le workshop. Mais c'est une communauté que je connais mal. Enfin, je connaissais un tout petit sous-ensemble et ça m'a permis de faire connaissance avec beaucoup de gens sympas et très forts et j'ai appris beaucoup de choses. En ce qui concerne Denis, donc d'habitude, comme disait Philippe, on dit des choses gentilles. Et pour Denis, c'est un peu difficile, mais vous vous souvenez de son astuce. Moi, je pense, je suis descendu en 88 à Sophia Antipolis. Je pense que Denis était déjà là, ou pas très loin d'y être. À l'époque, je faisais de la géométrie, de la vision par ordinateur, de la robotique, et je passais beaucoup de temps à courir derrière notre robot mobile qui n'arrivait pas à trouver son chemin et à éviter les obstacles, et à appuyer sur le bouton rouge qui était le stop-arrêt. Et donc Denis me croisait de temps en temps, il me regardait, qu'est-ce que c'est que ce fou ? Et puis, 20 ans plus tard, en 2015, j'étais passé aux neurosciences, et donc j'avais organisé une conférence à Juan-les-Pins, où j'avais organisé, donc c'était la première, et j'avais invité Denis et Philippe Protter, qui étaient là. Et donc, le jour du banquet, on était tous les trois sur un ponton, on sirotait notre champagne, et on croise un collègue qui avait présenté un article sur les limites champs moyens. Ce collègue était physicien. Et donc, il s'approche de nous, je présente, deux probabilistes de très grand talent. Et alors, il dit, qu'est-ce que vous avez pensé de ma présentation? Et je vois Denis qui le regarde et qui lui dit, je pense qu'on peut faire les choses de manière correcte. Donc ça, c'est tout à fait Denis. C'est-à-dire qu'il est franc et bon, voilà. Donc, et donc depuis ce jour-là, même avant, on essaie avec d'autres collègues de pousser vraiment le rôle des mathématiques en neurosciences. Et donc je vais vous parler de deux travaux. Alors d'abord, un travail commun avec Mireille Bossy et Denis Talley, et un travail commun avec Étienne Tanré, si j'ai le temps, mais peut-être pas. Donc je vais switch to English, maybe. Randomness in the brain. So this is real stuff. This is a system that allows people. This is in a paper by Ecker et al. In 2010. You see this big machine, this helmet is fixed on the skull of a monkey. It has very fine electrodes on top, and it allows to measure the activity of the neurons and to measure, in this case, the correlation between the spike trains Etienne was talking about. So this is vision. This is connected to computer vision and perception vision. So this is the kind of stimuli that the monkeys are shown. This is, you see, a grid pattern, and the little ellipses here represent what's called the receptive fields of the neurons. So each neuron in V1 has a receptive field, i.e. a small area in the retina it is sensitive to, and you see that these receptive fields are highly overlapping, so you might expect correlation. This is a real image, or is non-synthetic image. You have some plants, I don't know. But the main thing, the main finding is the following. You see this column here? It measures the correlation between various neurons, the activity between various neurons. And the black dots indicate previous results before this this study. And the red dots, or the red boxes, indicate the results of this study. So they found a very, very low correlation between the spiking activity of the neurons, despite the fact that they had very much overlapping receptive fields. So this is an interesting question. Is this a network effect, or is this related to the stochastic nature? And my guess was that it was perhaps related to this thing called the propagation of chaos, where things become independent. And in order to check this hypothesis, there was this piece of work But first, before I start describing the piece of work, I would like to show you. Etienne showed something. This is a These are two models of neurons. The first one, the top row, is the Hodgkin-Huxley model. They got the Nobel Prize in the 1950s for their model, groundbreaking model of a neuron. It's an ODE or SDE with four dimensions, state spaces four. And down below, it's the model I will, in fact, use in the presentation. It's a reduction to two dimension of the Hodgkin-Huxley model. It's called the Fitzhugh-Nagumo model, which I will now explain. So this is, as I said, this is joint work with Mireille and Denis. I will describe a little bit the model. I won't go into the details because This setup is probably well known to most of you in its generality, not in this, for this particular example, even though there are some interesting technical details which had to be worked out. So we work with the Hodgkin-Huxley model or one of its two-dimensional reductions. We have chemical synapses and the synaptic weights that Eva talked about are dynamically changing over time. There are several populations. So populations are indexed by Greek letters, and we have this population function which goes from the set of integers to the set of populations. Now, this is the dynamic system or system that describes the behavior of an isolated Fitzhugh-Nagumo model. So the variable V is indexed by I and T. I is the neural index. And there's a drift, which is cubic. And this is an interesting technical difficulties of this work. There is some noise, some Brownian on the membrane potential. And W is an adaptation variable that controls partly the variations of the potential, membrane potential VI. And P that means P of I equals alpha means that neuron I belongs to population alpha. I'm assuming that every neuron in the same population receives the same input. This is an external input, yes. This is a given. It would be interesting to try to estimate it from measurements, but it's not the case here. Okay, now getting into more details of the modeling, the neurons are connected by synapses, so there are synaptic currents, and the synaptic current between neuron I and neuron J, or neuron J and neuron Y in this case, is given by the above expression. There are two products, two terms in the product. The right-hand side is just the comparison with a threshold, which depends only on the populations of the two neurons. And there's an important term, which is the G sub I J, which is the conductance or conductivity, which itself is a product of two items. G sub I J is the synaptic weight. And Y sub J is something which is turns out to be very important. You can think of it as the proportion of open channels, ion channels, in the neuron J. And it's a number between 0 and 1. Okay, so there's a dynamics on these variables. The dynamics on the proportion, the fraction of open channels, Y sub I is written on top of the board. It's interesting. The most important term is the sigma gamma, the diffusion, the coefficient of the diffusion, which has this complicated form indicated here, because we are doing here a Langevin approximation of what in fact is a PDMP. And this is mostly the work of Gilles Wainwright and Michel Thielen and Pak Daman. And the function S, which appears here, is just the sigmoid that measures the activity or that controls the activity of the channels. The maximum conductances, the J sub ij's, can be described. They also vary in time. They can be described by this very simple SDE. It's very simple. The problem is that there is a strong law in biology, is that the law is that if a neuron is exciting at time t, J sub ij positive, it can never be inhibitory J sub ij negative. So this is not a good model because the sign can change, but this can be fixed by choosing another SDE. Now, putting everything together in a network, you get this interestingly looking set of stochastic differential equations. So again, we have the three variables, the membrane potential, the adaptation variable, and the channel gate variable. The extra terms in the variation of the membrane potential come from the interactions, precisely. And you can see, and some gamma, which appears here, I didn't mention it, it's the number of neurons in population gamma. And you have two types of Brownians, the Brownians on the membrane potentials and the Brownians on the channel equations. All right, so that's the network equations. And most of you can immediately read the limit equations on this system, and they are given here. So there's a convergence, we'll see that there is convergence toward one equation for each population, and the equations look very much like the previous ones, except that the summation on the y variable is replaced by the expected value of the corresponding variable. So this is a standard Makin-Vlasov system of equations. And in the work with Mireille and Denis, we tried to prove rigorously that this thing was overall well posed. So we need some hypotheses, which are listed here. I will not emphasize them, except the third one, which is important and unique. The function f sub alpha, which is here, okay, it's not Lipschitz, which causes some problems. They're continuous, but the one-sided Lipschitz with respect to V and Lipschitz with respect to W. So the well-posedness of the N-neuron model is very standard. There's a unique pathwise solution at all time on all time intervals, and very important, the Y sub IT, the conductance variables, stay between 0 and 1. It's a percentage of open channels. Now the mean field limit models same. It's a well posed problem, and again the YT sub alpha, which represent a meta conductivity variable, conductance variable, they stay between 0 and 1, and the proof basically follows standard work by Snitman. And some remarks in a paper, in 2014 paper by Luçon and Stanat. So let's call P the law of this solution. We have a convergence of the network equation toward the Makin-Vlasov equations, and the proof is very standard. So I will not spend too much time on it, except to emphasize this in this inequality here, which measures the difference between the network and the limit, the Makin-Vlasov equations. We have an unexpected term, which is square root of n. Usually it's n. This comes from the fact that we have only one-sided Lipschitz for f alpha with respect to the variable v. The definition of one-sided Lipschitz is down below here. Eva had asked me the question at the previous conference. All right, so the functions that that come up in the problem are f alpha, and this is j. This variable j is the intensity of the synaptic weight. So thanks to the fact that f sub alpha is one-sided Lipschitz, the processes are positive, which I said was important. The processes y sub it are between 0 and 1, and in fact the term, this term here, stabilizes all the moments of v sub I. Then we have convergence toward the of the network equations toward the Makin-Vlasov equation. So the student who was working at the time, Baladron, implemented this thing using the Fokker-Planck equation approach. And I will try. I blew my computer during the previous talk, so I hope this will not happen here. It doesn't want to wake up, so sorry. So anyway, the phenomena are interesting from the dynamic viewpoint, but here it doesn't show. Anyway, so we have movies that describe the time variation and perhaps the stationary distribution of the of the densities. Okay, sorry. So this is the end of the first story. So we were very happy to prove, exactly the fact that there was a convergence of the network system toward the Makin-Vlasov system and the propagation of chaos, which resonates with the original biological observation. Now, the second example is very different. Instead of looking at spikes like before, except I was not looking at spikes explicitly, but they were spiking neurons. Here, imagine that I take a large time window and I count the number of spikes in the window. And so the number of spikes divided by the time of the length of the window is the rate, the firing rate. And people use a lot this kind of model. It's like taking a de-zooming on the model. So the mathematical model is after the work of Benarus and Guillonnet, and this is, as I said, joint work with Etienne Thoy, ongoing joint work with Etienne Thoy. So as I said, we ignore the spikes and we consider only the firing rates. Okay, the intrinsic dynamics of the neuron is very much simpler than in the Hutchinson-Huxley case. It's just an Ornstein-Uhlenbeck model. Okay. And we call P the law of the solution of this thing. The set of trajectories is curly T. Now we have N neurons in a completely connected network, and I'm showing the coupled dynamics in the equation. S of JN is this the system. So you see we already again have the synaptic weights, J sub IJ, indexed by N when we look at the size N network. We have the initial condition. F is a sigmoid. Well, not always, but in this case, Lipschitz continues, which defines the firing rate. I.e., if you plug in membrane potential V in F, you get an activity. It's between 0 and 1, say. And you have Brownians.
Okay.
So I'm going to tell you what the J sub I J's are. But before that, for fixed J sub I J, there's a clearly unique strong solution. And I will call P of Jn its law on Tn, the set of n tuples of trajectories. Note that this is very close. Well, in fact, it's exactly a neural network. Neural networks, let me remind you that they work very well, but they are completely ill understood. So perhaps this is also a contribution toward a better understanding of these things. The J sub I J's, the synaptic weights. So in this example, there are IID random variables distributed, the scaling factor to make it things right. N of 0, 1, Gaussian random variables of 0 mean and variance 1. And let me go back to the equation. And if I ask you to guess the limit equations, I'm sure none of you will guess, will be able to guess, because they are very, very complicated and non-obvious. All right, so let me go through the analysis that Alice did some time ago and that we generalized to our case. She was working with soft spins, and but this is closely related. So P of Jn, the law of the solution of the system of neurons, is a random law. It's random because of J. Now, if we consider the law of n independent uncoupled neurons, so it's P tensored n times, we use Gersanov, which means, there's a side remark, that if there's no Brownian, which happens sometimes, then this method doesn't apply. Okay, so by Gersanov, you have an expression of the derivative of P of Jn with respect to P tensored n times. And this is really the key to this. So then this is well known to most of you. You take the empirical measure. This empirical measure, so the Dirac on the trajectory, the full trajectory. And of course, it defines a mapping from the set of trajectories to the set of laws on the trajectories, probability laws on the trajectories. And we are interested in the law of the empirical measure under P of Jn, the law of the system of neurons. But it's not exchangeable. If I was saying, so what do? You take the average of this law with respect to the random minimum, the synaptic weights, and you get another law, which is noted Q sub n. And the whole analysis is to study, the whole idea is to study the law of the empirical measure under Qn, even though from the practical standpoint, it's useless, because that means that in practice, you'd have to average over zillions of realizations of the network. But you'll see at the end, there's good news. So this is called in the physics literature annealed results, quenched and annealed. Annealed is averaged, and quenched is one realization. Okay, so now we consider the law of noted pi sub n of the empirical measure. It is a probability measure on the set of probability measure on the set of trajectories. So you're building powers of spaces. So you take a Borelian measurable set of P of T. The probability under pi sub n of B is Qn mu n minus 1, which is Qn of mu hat n belongs to B, the probability that the empirical measure belongs to that set B. Okay, so the strategy is to establish a large deviation principle for the sequence of probability measures. in order to do this, usually you have to define a rate function. The intuitive meaning is that the measures mu hat n will concentrate on the measures q, such that the rate function is zero. And if h reaches zero at a single measure, then pi sub n converges weakly toward the Dirac mass delta q, and you're happy there's a unique there's a unique solution. So by adapting the results in Benarus and Guillonnet, several papers, and one-node Sanmelides, also less well-known in 2002 in discrete time setting, then you prove that there's a rate function given by the expression that you can read. I2 is the relative entropy of mu with respect to p, so if they're not absolutely continuous, it's infinite. What else? And gamma is defined by the equation dqn dpn equals exponential n gamma mu hat of n. And h achieves its minimum at a unique point mu of p of t. And I recently discovered that Dembo, Lubetzky, and Zaytouni had proved that this result was universal. And I told that to Pierre-Louis Lyons, and he said, I'm not surprised. Paper is 30 or 40 pages of difficult proofs. But he was not surprised. Okay, but, all right. The problem is that, well, there's also the dynamics, as you will see. And that doesn't answer the question of the dynamics. All right, so I'm assuming you remember that the J sub I J's are Gaussian distributed. This is a very strong assumption, but it's okay. Okay, so the theorem H is the unique solution to the fixed point problem, which is expressed here. You recognize the form of the Gassanov theorem. And under, you see gamma mu, which is a notation to say that the GT mu that appears here is a centered Gaussian process with covariance given by the equation below. So you take a trajectory at time t and s, and you integrate over the trajectory f of vt and f of the product. And f, remember, is the activity, it's the sigmoid. Okay, this function is quite important. In fact, this form relation of the result has put most of the people in the domain in error, including myself. The reason is that it doesn't say anything about the relation between GT mu and the Brownian. So people have assumed in applications of this kind of results that G was independent of the Brownian, which it is not, as we will see. All right, and then, as written below, given a good deal of stochastic and Gaussian calculus, you can prove that mu is the law of the solution of a nonlinear, non-Markovian stochastic system, which is written. So xt equals x naught minus 0 to t xs. That's the kind of dynamics of the isolated neurons, plus bt. And bt is given by this apparently innocuous expression, wt, which is a Brownian under mu, and this double integral, which is a real pain in the neck, not to put it lower, as my friend Mike Brady would say, so it's a stochastic integral where k mu tilde is given, it's a covariance function. You have to twist the covariance in a very strange way, which we don't completely understand. K mu tilde is, you can think of these covariance matrices as operators in L2, you know, the linear kind of operator. And k mu tilde is given by the composition of these two operators. So it's very unintuitive thing. but that's life. All right, so we have this result in the case of zero mean. Then the second equation, and that's why I asked many people, what about the stochastic Volterra equations? The second equation, you see, it is almost a Volterra equation. By using this fact, you can actually solve for W for BT, and you get this nice and simple expression, where WT is the stochastic integral with respect to the mu Brownian motion, and H mu T is a function which falls out of the theory of, falls out from the theory of Volterra equations, and it's related very simply to the covariance function K mu tilde. And you have lots of bounds on the eigenvalues of this function H, or this operator H. Yes?
What are the bars?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, sorry. I mean, when I put a bar, I think of the correlation as an operator acting on L2. And when preparing the talk, I didn't take the time to explain. That's right, it's operator. It's thinking of the matrix or the function as a linear operator on L2. And there are also subtle things that you have to look at operators on L2 of zero small t. That's why there's a t upper index. And you have to be careful with that, but who cares? Except those who write the paper. Now, another interesting and nice thing that Etienne and I discovered that is that, once you know K mu, that's it. You have the system, you can simulate, you can do statistic, and so on and so forth. So how do you estimate K mu? Monte Carlo, of course. Monte Carlo, but thanks to Denis, you have to be rigorous. We proved that the fixed point procedure is well posed. It does work. And through the use of the solution to the previous Volterra equation, and again, you have to do a lot of stochastic and Gaussian calculus. Now, extensions to non-zero mean weights. Remember here, the weights are zero mean, the J sub by J's. Yeah, okay. And several populations of neurons are possible. We've done the non-zero mean case. These are the equations. This is the dynamics. Very close to the previous ones, except you have a new function which is related to the mean, of course. M mu of t is the mean of f of xt with respect to the limit measure. And the c mu, the term c mu of s ds is given by this operator. You have to apply identity plus k mu bar to minus one, which is invertible, of course. So you can see that the fact of adding a non-zero mean to the model is essentially like injecting a current in the neuron equation. And the current, the injected current is integral zero to t of c mu of s ds. And we have to understand this better again. Okay, I'm basically through. I'm early, but it's good. Propagation of chaos. There is propagation of chaos. Remember now that we're working with Q sub n. We're looking at the limit of the empirical measure under Q n, which is the averaged with respect to the weights. So the results are, as I said in my introduction or in the early presentation, it's marginally useful because you have to average over all possible networks. But in the case, quenched means one realization of the J sub I J. So the law of the empirical measure of the quenched system converges to delta mu for almost all J's. Theorem 2.7 in Benaus and Guillaume NIA5. But of course, this does not imply a quenched propagation of chaos, because as I said before, the neurons are not exchangeable. But you have this also very nice result. In probability, you do have propagation of chaos, i.e. if you take a set of functions phi sub j, m functions phi sub j, defined on the set of trajectories, you integrate with respect to the law of the solution of the n-dimensional size system, that it converges in probability toward the product of the integrals with respect to the limit law. That's a useful result for neuroscience. And I guess I'm done. Since I'm done early, this was too pessimistic. I would like to take a few minutes to advertise a new journal. I said that people like Eva, Etienne, Romain Veltz, myself, and several others, we really want to push the use of mathematics in neuroscience. So we started a new journal called Mathematical Neuroscience and Applications. Why not? And it's under the Diamond Model axis. It's run by AP Sciences, which is funded by CNRS and INERIA. And so it's free for those of you who don't know about the Diamond Model. It means it's free for the authors and for the readers. It's open science, if you wish, which we all like. So we have a few papers already published. If you go to the web page, which is very simple to remember, mna.episciences.org, you can see the papers, you can see the editorial board, Benoît Pertam, who's not here, he's on the board. Denis is not yet on the board, but soon will be. We have many good mathematicians on the editorial board, and the review process is just really, really, really very good. Anyway, so I encourage those of you who have something perhaps related, no, certainly related to neuroscience, to submit their work there. It's good for science and it's good for the community. I think. Thank you.